Ambassador Par Ahlberger, thank you very much for joining us today on Europe Now.
Thank you so much. I'm delighted to be here, and good initiative, I have to say.
Par, 2018 is a year that many analysts are saying involves stunning opportunities, as well as also new burdens for the European Union. I wonder if I could start by asking you how you would characterise the current state of the EU.
Obviously, there are challenges, and I guess that we're speaking mainly now to an Australian audience, although I understand that this interview will be accessible for a wider audience. But I direct myself to the Australians, if you don't mind them. So obviously, challenges. And last year in 2017, early 2017, the Swedish government presented a strategy, our strategy when it comes to European Union. And there were in particular three topics. There are three topics that were given priority to in 17, and that will be continue to be of a priority. It's jobs, obviously, job creation, innovation. It's the climate, and it's migration. Jobs, climate, and migration. And I would believe that most of the viewers here are not surprised of these priorities. So challenges in all these three areas, but personally I'm very optimistic about the future of the European Union.
In terms of some of those challenges that have been arising for the EU from the global financial crisis, the migration crisis, arguably no crisis has been as great for the EU than Brexit, and as we enter and move into 2018, Brexit has been cast, I guess, by some commentators as for every step forwards. Sometimes it's two or perhaps three steps backwards. But there's also a new sense in Europe, I think, that European nations are now moving beyond Brexit. And thinking about what comes next. I'm wondering what your view is of the EU 27 and what EU 27, can it do as much, if not more, than EU 28?
To start with, obviously we regret very much the decision. We respect it, but we regret it. And it's interesting, I was reading an article in The Economist, I think it was a year ago, and The Economist had been looking at voting patterns within the European Union to see which countries would have been the closest to the United Kingdom in the European Union. And it didn't come as a surprise to me or to us in Sweden that Sweden was the closest to the United Kingdom. I forgot the exact figure now, but I think it was around the 95-96% of the votes. We had an identical vote as the United Kingdom. And in particular in trade, being trade, you know, focused liberal countries, we have lost, and we will lose one of our most important allies. Mm. So it is a blow, but we need to look beyond that, as you indicated. And it's too early, even though now we are in 2018. It's too early to see the consequences. But I can tell you this much, that for us in Stockholm, we have an understanding now that we need to form possibly new alliances within the European Union with countries that by tradition haven't been that close to us, to widen that. That is obvious, and I think Sweden is not unique in this. Germany is obviously have always been a close partner of Sweden. But you have also seen some very encouraging initiatives between France and Sweden. So the President Macron from France visited Sweden last year in 2017, and there were a few initiatives launched together with my Prime Minister. Mm.
I'll come to some of those opportunities and challenges in a bit more detail in a moment, but just to stick with Brexit just one moment longer, the legendary German public intellectual Jürgen Habermas recently criticised not only the UK government, but interestingly European governments more generally, for what he called the handing out of tranquilizers. the handing out of tranquilizers, quite a lovely phrase. And what Habermas was seeking to underscore was the very reductive debate that's taken place on whether a country, albeit a major country, is in the single market or not, rather than the broader debate about not only the economic challenges, but the cultural and the political challenges of globalization. Habermas is wondering why there's not a greater debate about migration, about the rise of Trump and protectionism, and so on and so forth. Just wondering from your own standpoint and from the viewpoint of Stockholm, your reaction to that, and whether you think there's merit to that line of thinking. Has the debate been too reductive, too limiting?
I think he's right. When it comes to Sweden, if I may elaborate a bit on that.
Yes.
So the background is that Sweden became a member of the European Union fairly late, as you know, 1995. One of the reasons why we had a majority in the referendum that took place was the economic crisis that we had in the Nordic region at that time. So the way it was presented, the European project at that referendum, was very much focused on the economy, the need for Swedish companies to gain access to the internal market and so forth. So that has been the focus in the Swedish debate for long. But I think he's absolutely right that, as is often stated, the European integration and the European Union is one of the most successful peace projects that we have seen. I guess, personally, that it's a bit of a challenge. It's not that easy to explain this and to sell that to the public. It's easy to look at the, you know, works and economy. But I think he's absolutely right to present what the European Union is all about, the peace project, integration between people.
Climate change remains very high on the political agenda, though recently French President Macron has argued that the world is losing the battle against climate change. Wondering what you think the EU can do now to re-engage the battle against climate change, and secondly, what Sweden is currently doing.
As I mentioned, so three priorities within the European Union for the government: jobs, climate, and migration, in no particular order. For us, maybe it's not well known to the viewers, but we had elections in 2014 in Sweden. For the first time, the Green Party formed a coalition, a government with the Social Democratic Party. So climate, environment, irrespective of that, but that's a sort of political background, which is good to know, is on the top of the agenda. And just before we got started with this interview, I mentioned that I'm the ambassador to 11 countries in the region, and we engage heavily with the South Pacific on climate. The single most important, of course, important priority we have is the Paris Agreement, that has to be supported by the European Union. And last year, the Swedish government presented a strategy within the European Union, and you can download it from our website gov.se for those who are interested. And it's absolutely clear the Paris Agreement is top of the agenda. But obviously, Agenda 2030 and the Sustainable Development Goals have a particular importance. The implementation of this, and what I try to do as an ambassador here in Australia is to engage with the business community. I think they have a tremendous importance in the implementation of the SDGs together with Global Compact. So Paris, SDGs, and if you would ask me, so are there any particular SDGs that are more important than others? Maybe not, but in our case, Sweden, we have engaged in particular when it comes to SDG number 14, Oceans and the Seas. I also mentioned to you just before we got started here that Sweden and together with Fiji co-hosted a UN conference in New York in 2017, and that will be followed up on.
Right. The EU has recently clinched a major trade deal with Japan, a free trade agreement following on from the agreement with Canada, the single largest open trade agreement following global rules that we've seen. And of course, there's a preliminary set of discussions taking place now between the EU and Australia on the FTA. What's your I mean, this is hugely consequential, isn't it? I mean, particularly against that, the political backdrop of this rise of protectionism in some quarters that we're seeing.
You're absolutely right. And if you start with Australia then, in these uncertain times, like-minded countries obviously need to come together in a way that we haven't seen before. My personal experience, I've been posted to a few countries, Beijing and China and then Singapore before, for 8 years in Asia. My personal experience from coming here to Australia is that, you know how it is, you invest more time in possibly markets, countries that are a bit more challenging. The like-minded countries, like-minded friends, you take them for granted. What I absolutely see now is that we have a momentum here. I believe you see it here in Canberra and certainly in Stockholm, that like-minded countries need to come together. So you are absolutely right. The upcoming FTA negotiations between EU and Australia, and for that matter also New Zealand, is of tremendous importance now. This is the time to do it. And we engaged, and the Swedish government have been very early in supporting these FTAs. And we have a large business community, Swedish business community in Australia. It's interesting, this is no exact science, but approximately 20,000 Australians, 20,000 Australians work for Swedish related companies. And these companies, they generate another 60,000 jobs here in Australia. So we have a big interest. Australia is the fourth largest trading partner for Sweden outside Europe.
Right.
Fourth largest.
Yeah.
So it's a lot on at stake now.
Yeah, I'll come back to that.
Sorry.
No, that's fine. Par, you've been ambassador here in Australia since 2014. Can you just tell me a little bit about the personal context of how you came to Australia and your background, your European background within the EU?
Yeah, so I have a strong academic background on the European Union. I studied in Bologna, and this was early 90s. And it was funny, when I got my grades, I still have them somewhere in my office. It was funny because all the courses I took had to do with European integration at that time. This was early 90s. Obviously, a few years before the referendum, a few years before the economic crisis that we faced. But I have personally a great interest in European integration. After that, I worked for the European Free Trade Association in Geneva before Sweden became a member of the European Union. And I also worked at the EU Commission, where I met my wife from France. So European integration at its at its best.
Indeed.
But later on, as I mentioned, it was very much Asia. So there is a sort of logic in me being here. Right. And I feel very strongly now, as I said, we have a momentum between Australia and Sweden, and for that matter, the European Union. Let's make the most out of it. There are not that many truly like-minded countries around. We are certainly like-minded. These are uncertain times. We face similar challenges. And I think now is the time to invest a bit more in each other than we have done in the past.
I'd like to ask you finally something about the future, and ask you to perhaps try to look through your ambassadorial crystal ball out to something like the year, say, 2050. What what would you most like to see, and what do you think is possible in terms of generally the development and the deepening of the relationship between Australia and the EU, and specifically the relationship between Australia and Sweden?
Then I'm coming back to the momentum that I see. When I took on the post, this post in 2014, as was mentioned, I was a bit surprised. There are always surprises, you know, waiting for you when you take on a new post. I don't know about your own experience, but that's my experience in the past. And Canberra was not an exception. I was surprised of the lack of knowledge at the embassy of the commercial relations, the size. And the importance of Australia. And as I mentioned, I gave you a few figures on which is surprised me, I mean, the size of it. I think this will continue to deepen and broaden the commercial relations, absolutely. I have a particular interest also in academic contacts. We have approximately 1,800 Swedish students as exchange students in Australia each year. Australia is the third largest destination for Swedish students. And I see no reason why that couldn't be expanded further, although we are number three after the US and the UK. So more Swedish students coming to Australia and more trade. And the FTA, obviously, I know that from past experience. I was the ambassador in Singapore when we negotiated an FTA with ASEAN. And as you know, an FTA creates an interest, a political interest in the commercial relations and beyond the commercial relations, actually. So I have very high expectations on the FTA,
right,
further, you know, creating an interest, a mutual interest in each other,
yes,
being higher up on the agenda,
yes,
beyond trade.
Yeah, yeah. Ambassador Ahlberger, thank you very much for joining us on Europe Now. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for the initiative. Thank you.